with you.
And with your spirit.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
And good afternoon to those who are praying with us on live stream as we come together to celebrate the Eucharist. We are gathered here to participate in the banquet of the Eucharist. And we are here because God, in his love for us, has invited us, and we have accepted his invitation. In thanksgiving, we call to mind those times when we have refused God's invitation of love.
Guide us along the right paths.
May your grace, O Lord, we pray, at all times go before us and follow after, and make us always determined to carry out good works. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will provide for all peoples a feast of rich food and choice wines, juicy, rich food and pure choice wines. On this mountain, he will destroy the veil that veils all peoples, the web that is woven over all the nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord God will wipe away the tears from every face. The reproaches of the people he will remove from the whole earth. For the Lord has spoken. On that day it will be said, "Behold our God, to whom we look to save us. This is the Lord for whom we looked. Let us rejoice and be glad that he has saved us. For the hand of the Lord will rest on this mountain." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I shall live in the house of the Lord all
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, I know how to live in humble circumstances. I know also how to live with abundance. In every circumstance and in all things, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of living in abundance and of being in need. I can do all things in him who strengthens me. Still, it was kind of you to share in my distress. My God will fully supply whatever you need in accord with his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father, glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. He dispatched his servants to summon the invited guests to the feast, but they refused to come. A second time, he sent other servants, saying, "Tell those invited, behold, I have prepared my banquet. My calves and fattened cattle are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the feast." Some ignored the invitation and went away, one to his farm, another to his business. The rest laid hold of his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged and sent his troops, destroying those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, "The feast is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy to come. Go out, therefore, into the main roads and invite to the feast whomever you find." The servants went out into the streets and gathered all they found, bad and good alike, and the hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to meet the guests, he saw a man there not dressed in a wedding garment. The king said to him, "My friend, how is it that you came in here without a wedding garment?" But he was reduced to silence. Then the king said to his attendants, "Bind his hands and feet and cast him into the darkness, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Many are invited, but few are chosen." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, we just heard Jesus tell a parable within a parable, and it's all about invitations and RSVPs. We've got a king sending out invitations. You are cordially invited to the wedding of my son. Now, if you got one of those invitations, you probably are enticed by the menu. Juicy, rich foods, prime rib au jus carved to your liking, pure choice wines. And every person who got that invitation refuses to come. A second invitation is sent. Many excuses, too busy, got other plans. Did you notice it all ended in violence? Some of the invited murder the inviters. And the outraged king orders his servants to offer a third invitation. Go out, invite street people, everybody you can find, good people, bad people. And they all show up. Every chair is taken. Now here comes the story within the story. The king goes around greeting all the guests, and he eyes one man not properly dressed. How is it that you came in here without a wedding garment? And the king ups and throws the man out, yelling, many are invited, few are chosen. Would you like to have been the person thrown out? Now, you probably already figured this out. That parable is your story and it's mine. The wedding feast is where we are right now. We are at the banquet of the Lord. Jesus invites and re-invites us Sunday after Sunday to come to our parish church, to Mass, to celebrate and share in the rich food and choice wine of his Eucharist. His body, his blood, really, truly present. And every Sunday, by our presence here, our RSVP is a yes. And we do know that there are many people who say no. And yes, it's all about the proper garment each of us needs to wear. Now, theologians tell us the wedding garment is our baptism. But you know, maybe that's just too vague to entice us. St. Augustine, centuries and centuries ago, defined the garment. It needs to be stitched with a pure heart, good conscience, sincere faith. So that is what we wear. Have you all got it on today? Our garment of sincere faith. The parable king called those invited who did not show up unworthy. Now, even though we are all here this afternoon, do you notice that we pray that same word, unworthy, just before receiving communion? Lord, I am unworthy. I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. But only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. That is why we come properly dressed in our baptismal garment of sincere faith. This garment is provided to those who follow Jesus. God the Father invites us to the eternal banquet in honor of his Son. Not wearing the garment implies that we do not believe Jesus is the Son of God. This parable is never about who is invited. The parable is about who freely chooses to answer the invitation. Now let's stop and look at the busyness of our lives. We're all busy doing this, that, and the other thing. And Jesus says to us that we need to wear our garment of faith all the time. Well, look what's going on in our own lives, in our families, at work, schools, homes, communities, and in the world. COVID-19 has turned us upside down. We have a very divided nation. The biting rhetoric our leaders and ourselves hurl at one another. The sinful ugliness of racism, hurtful bullying, minority groups treated as less than deserving of human rights and respect, threats against the right to life, conflicts raging between nations and races and religions. Everybody has an opinion about everything, and no one hesitates to voice it. Natural disasters of hurricanes and firestorms, addictions causing suffering in families, and all those and more take a heavy toll on our own lists of crosses, illnesses, regrets that we each personally carry every single day. Are we wearing our baptismal garment of a pure heart, good conscience, sincere faith? Does it clothe us? Does it give us hope? Well, here we are. Jesus extends his invitation to us. He feeds us with the best of food, himself. He brings us together as one family in the middle of all the circumstances of our lives. And on this Columbus Day and Canadian Thanksgiving weekends, we're invited again. St. Paul gives us great encouragement in the second reading today. My God will fully supply whatever you need in accord with his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. And even with all our own questions and all our own concerns, our response to the Lord's invitation needs to be yes. And as we just sang a little while ago, I shall live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. God bless you all.
Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in
the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Our loving God provides a banquet for us and wipes away the tears from every face. Let us now bring to God in prayer the needs of all our brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus.
Loving God, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may recognize God's invitation to life and service and respond generously with dedication and commitment, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For peace in our cities and communities, that God will help us to understand the pain of those who have suffered injustice and give us the courage to work for reconciliation, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For wisdom, that God will help us hear and discern the truth during the election process and help us to respect each person as we recognize their strengths and weaknesses, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For the grace of openness, that we may welcome and offer hospitality to all who enter our Christ and one another in our celebration each week, we pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
For all who are sick and suffering, especially those with COVID, and for a full recovery of President Trump and First Lady Melania. For those who have died, and for those who mourn them, especially Shirley Phillips, Millie Passino, Dennis Boudet, that God will welcome them to the eternal banquet in heaven, and at this liturgy we remember in a special way Flo Black. We pray.
Loving God, hear our prayer.
Lord, may we love you in all things and above all things, and reach the joy you have prepared for us, which is beyond all our imagining, the banquet of peace of heaven. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the all of his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, the prayers of your faithful with these sacrificial offerings, that through these acts of devotedness we may pass over to the glory of heaven. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity made the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the Church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
When we meet
today,
death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray, that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Bishop Terry, the Valley, our Bishop, and all the clergy.
Remember your servants,
our brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, with St. Alexander and St. James and all of the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be.
Thank you.
Let us pray. We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may make us sharers of his divine nature, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
We have one announcement. So could everyone turn over here towards the organ? Guess whose birthday it is? So we're not gonna ask him to play, we're just gonna make him sit there. This is Ben, our organist, and we're gonna sing to him. But would you like to give us a chord?
What key do you want?
What key do you want to hear him sing? All right, here we go, bud.
Happy birthday.
Extra envelopes are available at the entrances of church. A reminder that letters with raffle tickets for the Harvest Dinner went out. If you did not receive them, then give us a call. We're certainly happy to get you some. Also, we're also glad to have back among us Father Garvin, one of our retired priests, coming out from COVID hibernation, and we're so glad to have him back with us. So thank you, everyone.
Mass is in. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.